Ruchi Gupta and the whole organizing team of ISSB Con Amritsar. It has been a wonderful conference and with a lot of memories. So my topic is regarding the percutaneous balloon compression for the trigeminal neuralgia. This is me already. This is disclaimer. I have been the international proctor for the SYM Medical for their PBC percutaneous balloon compression kit with the name of Metrenew. Consent has been taken from the patients. This is my institute, Dr. Ramanur Lohia Institute of Medical Sciences, Lucknow, where we are working. So classification, as Dr. Before me has just classified it. So I will just go very fast. So primary essentially idiopathic most of the time. Vascular compression is the most commonly found anatomical finding. Secondary, we all know, multiple sclerosis and tumor. Features again, we are talking about the classical type, that is type 1, also known as type 1, where unilateral electric shock like pain, abrupt onset and termination, and pain free interval is the key to make the diagnosis whether it is a classical type or not. So all interventions we all know that we do the glycerol, retrocasserine rhizolysis, we do radio frequency ablation, and we do the balloon compression. This talk is particularly about, and in all three interventions we go in the, as you can see that there is a gastrin ganglion, three roots are coming, V1, V2, V3, and different type of intervention does the different thing. Here you can see the balloon is going inside the gastrin ganglion and compressing it against the petrous temporal bone. Here you are putting the glycerol in the cistern, which is again causing the demyelination changes in the and provides relief. And radio frequency is selective. You can target the particular part of ganglion to do the lesioning. So percutaneous balloon compression is comparatively fairly new technique. Not now anymore, but in 83, it was Dr. Mullan and Dr. Lister and described this technique, both are neurosurgeon. Approach are same for all three techniques, that is given by Dr. Hartel more than 100 years ago, transoval to reach the gastrin ganglion. So again, another picture where you can see the gastrin ganglion, roots are coming, and this is the lower part is the root which we use to go there in the foramen ovale and the gastrin ganglion. So all procedures in all the three techniques, we use the same technique, patient remains supine, CM fluoroscope is the way to go. Submento vertex view to see the foramen ovale, entry point is around 1 inch or 3 centimeters lateral to the angle of mouth, but that again may vary slightly because as depending on the angulation of your CM. Gun barrel and coaxial view is used to reach the foramen ovale. So this is the balloon compression kit. You can see that there is a manometer in between. This is a new thing. It was not available with us in India at least. We were using normal Fogarty balloon and 14 gauge catheter. But this kit has got good equipment like manometer and specialized made balloon where you can see there are multiple marks. So this marks reaches up to the length of cannula. I will show in the video also. And this is 1 inch ahead of this. So the length of foramen ovale and Meckel's cape considered to be around 1 inch. So we reach there through this method. So this is just the pictures we have taken of our volunteer. So how to make the submental view, positioning of CR. So you take a AP picture, then you make it a caudocephalic, then you make the ipsilateral oblique to see the foramen ovale which comes in between the mandible and the maxilla. So this is a small video, yes. Today we are going to do a percutaneous balloon compression of our patient who is having trigeminal neuralgia of right V1 and V2 division. Patient is suffering from 8 years plus, and today we are going to use this dedicated kit from SYM Medical for the percutaneous balloon compression. Now I am going to demonstrate what are the different parts of this kit. This balloon will be used for the inflation after we place it inside the Meckel's cape. this is the pressure manometer. Here you can see, and this is this small strip is for the battery operation. We will peel it off. Then this is the puncture needle, which has got different marks, which we are, it has got a blunt distillate inside the needle. This is a blunt distillate, and this is the outer sheath, which will stay at the foramen ovale mouth, and this slit will come out. After this distillate has come out, we will use different type of dilator to make our way inside the gasserin ganglion through this outer sheath. And after removing this, we will thread our balloon. These are different syringes. So here you can see that we have removed this strip, and now this has been started. This pressure manometer has been started. And here are three modes by which we can see pressure in the ATM, KPA or MMHG. So I am going to use it in MMHG to measure the pressure. This is off switch. Currently it is in the off direction, and now this is in the on direction. So when we will inflate it with the dye, we will keep it in the on direction. Once we have completed the inflation, we will make it off so that dye does not come out. So now I am going to fill and pre-check this balloon, tighten it up, and we are going to take some dye. I am going to inflate the balloon with, this is a 1 ml capacity balloon. I am going to inflate it. First we have to make it on. Yes, we have make it on, just inflating it, and slowly, gradually, you can see that it is taking a shape and it is intact. Now keeping this side down and this side up, we are going to deflate this balloon twice or thrice so that we can remove the air. A balloon is a balloon assembly with the pressure manometer is ready, and now we are going to puncture the patient's foramen ovale to reach the Becker's cave where we want to work. So now you can see that patient is in general anesthesia, and we are using CRM fluoroscope to reach and locate this foramen ovale. We are taking first a caudal inclination. Then ipsilateral oblique inclination. To locate the foramen ovale of the right side of patient. This is the foramen ovale between the mandibular and maxilla. Puncture needle has got a blunt tip. We need to make a small puncture wound again on the foramen ovale. A small puncture wound, hardly of 2 mm size, so that our needle can go easy. We are going trying to reach the foramen ovale in the gun barrel view on the C-arm. We have just engaged the foramen ovale. We are going to check it in the AP picture, and in the seems to be okay in AP picture. Now we are going to check the lateral picture. So we have to come out slightly. I am going to remove the stillet of outer cannula, and here you can see that our needle is still in the place that is at the foramen ovale. Now we are using a stillet which is again blunt, but it is going to make our way easy for the use in the foramen ovale and to thread our balloon catheter easily. We are going to slowly advance it, reach where we want it to reach. Now our balloon is ready. We are going to thread it at the same place where our cannula is reached. Here you can see the tip of balloon, it is going in
first mark, and it is showing that we have reached up to the tip, and now we are going ahead. Here,
you should be able to see the mark. Now I am going to connect the dye filled syringe,
and now I am going to inject the dye gradually, slowly.
You can see that it is coming in a beautiful ear shape. I have injected and I have made it off. Now time difference.
And we have injected around 0.8 ml of dye into the balloon.
We are also going to check it in the AP picture, and we are going to inflate this balloon for 90 seconds. Okay, later again.
Time has over, so we are going to deflate again. Open the manometer in the on position and going to deflate it.
And then you can see that the balloon has been deflated completely. Now we are going to take the balloon back slightly up to the first mark near to the tip, and to take out press, compress for 5 minutes at least, so that there are no chances of any leakage of blood or CSF.
So this was the video how to do it. We have done it under local anesthesia and conscious sedation also, but recently, since last 1 or 2 years, we have started it under general anesthesia. Advantage of balloon compression is that it is useful in elderly as well as young patients, especially useful for V1 neuralgia because of the different mechanism of action. Here we are breaking the sensory arm of the trigeminal reflex or pain by affecting the A alpha and beta fibers, which are the sensation carrying fibers. There is slight loss hypesthesia in most of the patient, but it usually recovers over 6 months to 1 year, and they are comfortable with it. It's technically easy, but and patient cooperation is not required here. For radio frequency, you need a patient cooperation that he understands what you are saying, and immediate post pain relief in more than 90% patient. Almost all of our patients are waking up from general anesthesia free of carbamazepine. This is one big advantage which we are finding with this. What are the disadvantages? There are slight motor weakness. Then there are chances of infection. It is a complete minimally invasive but advanced procedure. So you need to take care of surgical asepsis while doing this thing. There are some patients, fortunately very rare, they are having some dysesthesia, which again gets better with some amount of TCA lipo drugs. Transient otalgia is there after the intervention, which again gets better within in the day. One thing which is doing this thing is severe bradycardia. It's fairly common, so you need to have one of your anesthesiology colleague along with you to take care of this thing. Even transient asystolic may happen. These are all the complications which may happen, but if the technique is wrong, you are not sure where you are reaching, because cannula is quite 14 gauge cannula, so it is big. Secondly, another complication are hematoma may happen, facial numbness, anesthesia dolorosa also have been reported. Fortunately, we haven't found it yet. Herpes labialis is one common thing which we find around 20-30% patient, the report of herpes labialis in the first week. So complication, if you see the chart, comparative chart, is most of the complication are with the radio frequency thermocoagulation, and yellow one is the balloon. So complication are comparable to the radio surgery, that is gamma knife surgery. There are multiple studies now. We are also going to publish one head-to-head trial with the radio frequency, and most of them have reported almost 90-100% relief, and with fairly comparable complication and side effects. So to conclude, is an amazing treatment option for trigeminal neuralgia, especially in the type 1, though I would like to report the house that we have used in few cases of type 2 trigeminal neuralgia or perhaps neuropathy, and with the fairly good results. We were even not convinced that it will work, but it has worked. So this is this technique should be more employed by most of the pain physician. It's a powerful technique. and this is my Facebook and YouTube channel where all these videos are also available for the later watching if someone is interested. Best regards from my institute, that is Dr. Raman Holdoy Institute of Medicine, Medical Sciences. Thank you for the patience.
Thank you, Dr. Abraham, for the wonderful presentation, and video presentation was excellent, Dr. Abraham.
Dr. Anurag, you said the 0.8 ml you are using dye, but what about the dead space covered by the...
Actually, we started with 1 ml syringe. While I was doing the deaeration, so that deaeration consumes some dye. So around 0.2 to 0.3 ml deaeration, that lumen takes 0.2 to 0.3 ml of dye.
What is the pressure you maintain?
Pressure we don't maintain. Pressure we only measure. So what I have found in the pressure in most of the patient of Indian, this is around 200 kPa. That becomes unbelievable high pressure, that becomes around 2100 mmHg. In fact, before we got this kit, I have been trying since last many years to measure the pressure, and we used all manometers available to us. I started with the cuff pressure monitor in our OTs, then I switched over to the arterial pressure, CVP manometer, and then one fine day we used arterial pressure monitoring system on the anesthesia workstation. But every time pressure surpassed. So when we used this for the first time, so I was like crazy to know that we are creating around 2000 millimeter of mercury pressure with just 1 ml of dye. So it was a finding for me. So we are trying to find the correlation between pressure and the duration of relief and side effect. Till now, abhi मैं कुछ बोल नहीं सकता वो स्टडी के बारे में, क्योंकि वो लॉन्ग टर्म में ही पता चलने वाला है।
Because आपने बोला कि लीवर के लिए आइडियल है, suppose the patient is you're using it for liver, but you're producing the lesion in the even EV2 V3.
Yes, yes, this is non-selective.
What about the patient complaint?
Is you rarely get, personally I have rarely got any patient who is suffering only from V1. Why it is ideal for V1? Because it is not, in most of the patient corneal sensation is intact. So
at this cost you are involving the V2 V3 also.
Yes, yes, but actually there are multiple papers from abroad where they have done the cadaveric studies after compression. So what they have found, it is not getting destruction, like radio frequency is burning, you know, whatever we call it is ablating the tissue, we are burning it off. Here we are not burning it off. What they have found, that there are changes at the electron microscopy level, and they are affecting more of A alpha and beta fibers. So we are affecting, we are targeting all things, non-selective, like glycerol. Glycerol is non-selective, this is also non-selective.
What duration of relief you have found in your studies?
Wonderful. Until now, we are following all the patients. Lot of them have been lost to follow because of change in the number.